Hello everyone, before we start the video, here's a quick reminder that you can join my Discord server. We are building a nice Dota 2 community, so be part of it. Also, if you haven't subscribed yet, you can click the subscribe button, and now let's get started with the video. So today, this is gonna be part 2 of the Monkey King guide, and I want to explain to you why I built certain items and where I go on the map and what I do in teamfights. So here, I always buy Battle Fury on this hero when I play him safe lane. You really want to have a farming accelerator because a lot of people just don't understand that this hero is very, very strong in the late game. If you check your talents, like every talent is pretty good. I will explain a bit later what talents I choose. But I just want to jump to the 25 talents because for me that's one of the most game-changing talent in this game for like every hero. If you get the additional Wukong's command ring, your team fight basically completely changes and you become from having a pretty good ult to like an insane ult. Also that goes obviously to your level 30 if it goes really really late game. You get the plus 100 armor on your Wukong's command ring, so you're basically immune to physical damage. And you have the giant ring, which is very hard to leave for your opponents. Also, you are a very good Divine Rapier carry, so that's another thing that really benefits for this hero. That's why I think the hero is like a very, very strong safe lane carry. And especially with a lot of items, like he can scale very well and deal with a lot of current popular heroes. And I just want to show you like how I play it right now. So first of all, I finished my Battle Fury, 15 minutes, it's pretty good timing. Looking at net worth, second highest, Klings is a bit higher. But right now, what I want to do is I basically want to just focus on farming as much as I can. So, wait, hold on. Okay, go on my player perspective. Alright, so just gonna farm their side of the map as aggressive as I can. And what your team should actually do, like what is the difference between like having a Monkey King with Battle Fury and having a anti-mage with Battle Fury? It's kinda easy explained. The AM just needs more items to get very strong. Like if he has a Battle Fury, it's not a real threat for you in team fights. He can do some damage if he gets to hit, but usually that's the issue, like that he can't really hit people. So this hero is like completely different. You have a stun, you have a slow, you have a pretty good ult for team fights. So getting the battlefield does not only mean you have to farm, farm, farm. You can also like fight very well. Therefore, I think this hero is just a bit better than anti-mage in this current situation here. So with my team, what I want to do them is, if they smoke right now, like they want to smoke, and I can already tell you this was a very tough game, even though my score is going to be like 15-0 in the end. But they were playing like they never played this game before. So what I want to do them is, I am obviously alone top lane right now, pushing their wave in, farming their jungle, and no one is showing on the map. And if they smoke, I want them to smoke towards me. But where they're going is, they're going to go to that triangle. And that's completely wrong, like you want to smoke towards your carry. To have any like if a team fight is starting, he can be there. Like I cannot be here in the triangle, like there's no way I can get here. But if we smoke instead towards the top lane, we could get AM, like he will show on the lane here pretty soon. We could have jumped in there, but since they're not going here, it's like not happening. That was just a quick rant for me about my team. But now back to Monkey King. Yeah, like I said, you basically just want to farm, farm, farm for as much as you can. You should always get an Echo Saber as your second item. That's how I do it. A lot of people would say, why build Echo Saber? It doesn't work on your ult anymore. That is true, but for me, Echo Saber, first of all, it is an option to have people like be in your ult, because the one you hit obviously gets the slow from Echo Saber. And Echo Saber also allows you to get your Jinko stack very quickly on a like on a target that is stunned, and you want to get the Jinko stacks very quickly and then burst him with your Boundless Strike. So For me, Echosaver is just a very good item on the Zero overall. Also, now you can like build it into a Shadow Blade and then to the Silver's Edge. It's pretty good Silver's Edge game this game for the break ability against Bristleback or against AM. So it makes a lot of sense here to buy Echosaver too. So after like farming the triangle and pushing in their wave here for a lot of time, I got my Echosaber, I got my Magic Wand Battlefury, Orb of Venom, Power Treads and Wraith Band. Like I have a very strong tool right now to fight. And now this team, my team is smoking and I'm drawing the line where they should go, like this time they actually go towards me. And this will result in a favorable team fight for us. Right now what I do is basically what I did the whole game is, I'm gonna push in this wave and then farm their camps here, go back to triangle and then again towards the lane, push it in when it's pushed. And this is like your farming rotation you do all the time. That's how you do it with like every carry. In some games you can't do that because, for example, the offlane is occupied by the opponents for whatever reason. So doesn't mean if people say it in videos or you read it in guides or something, you need to push in the offlane as much as you can. Doesn't mean you have to actually do it in every game. It's always it's just a tool, I would say. And if you use the tool or not is like depending on the game. And for Dire, obviously, it's the same thing. If you're playing Dire, you can farm the triangle here, push in the wave here, and then again go towards the camps, farm them, back to the triangle, farm it, and just do this circle over and over and over again. This is where you get a lot of farm. Like, this is the most efficient farm routine you can have. So right now, again, going towards the top lane, pushing it in. And this time, AIM will jump me with this Manta. I'm not really sure what he tried to accomplish with that. Maybe just want to scare me off or something. But since I knew, okay, my team is coming, I'm not like completely backing out. Just gonna stun him so I don't lose all my mana. Didn't really matter because in the end I lost all my mana. But yeah, we get a good jump on him. And gonna kill him very quickly. Didn't get my Jingle Stacks, unfortunately, but that's fine. Now we're gonna have a favorable team fight. I don't know what that RP was, but he RP'd the ground. And here, can just put down my ult, gonna get a kill on Magnus. And what I do now is I don't really want to leave this area now, then my ult would disappear. I have Jingle Stacks and I have my stun ready, so I'm looking for a target that I can go on. Best target here would be Klings because he's gonna do a ton of damage. So I'm kind of looking, can I jump Klings? I couldn't really do that, so I just finish off Bristleback real quick. But I was stunning Klings in the end, so he can't like chase down my teammates. And after a teamfight, do what you always do, back to farming. Can't really take an objective, it was a 3-for-3 trade, even though we got a good kill in the beginning. It didn't really turn out to be the greatest teamfight. I actually thought it would be better, but seems like it wasn't. And right now, that's actually a build I'm not recommending, you should always do. But like I said, this game is first of all a good game for Silver Edge. And I was a bit disappointed with like my teammates, they were not really communicating that well and I didn't really know if I could like trust them the whole game. Usually I'm not the biggest fan of going for item builds that don't really rely on teammates and just play my own game. But in this game I actually did it. I'm rushing the Silver Edge very early so I can use the Shadowblade effect, like be invis and try to get solo pickoffs. Try to kill the Bristleback very easily, try to get like on Sniper in the back line, try to get maybe Klings or something. So that's like my main reasoning why I buy it. In a usual game where I would not rush it and if I had like teammates that would communicate better or would not be mega tilted or anything, like people that are willing to play as a team, I would probably buy Basher here, but like I said, my reasoning for Silver's Edge already explained it. So I'm going for Silver's Edge at the moment. Just want to finish it real quick, so I'm gonna stick in a triangle again, like I said, farm it up, and now I'm gonna jump to a usage of my Silver Edge, how I use it to make a good play with it. So he actually took Roshan before we, before I did something with my Silver's Edge. So right now we are starting a fight going on Sniper here. I am using my Silver's Edge at the moment, running in, and I had options what I could do. Like I could have run a Bristleback here. But I kinda decided against it because I feel like he's not a threat at all with his items at the moment. So there wasn't really that needed to go on him now. Gonna kill this sniper because he can kite me more with his shrapnel and then his Aghanim's ult can stun me for such a long time. So that's like my main concern, getting him out. And after that, I can freely chase with my teammates now. Just gonna chill out a bit, see what's happening. If I can get a pick or not, pushing in the wave here because like you obviously want to get a tower too. So after taking the mid tower, I immediately TP'd bottom to push it out. And that's my playstyle. Like I already explained, you want to farm as much as you can. You are a really scaling core hero that needs items and you want to get those items. You can think about the hero like a PA or like an anti-mage TB. Get your items and you're very, very strong. So right now, this is like the last minute or something for my Aegis. I see that their team, I'm not sure if they are all here right now, but I just see Bristleback bottom at this time, and I know I can kill him very easily. I scouted here if there is someone, like if there's Magnus or something hiding here, but he wasn't, so I can freely go on him. Just gonna kill him real quick. And since Sand King is going now, I can have a basically free fight. Gonna kill Sniper here now, then RP is like kinda wasted on me. Instead of my Aegis, and here's the power of Jingu, I can fight back, have a lot of lifesteal. I die in the end, but I had Aegis, so it didn't really matter. Gonna get a kill here on Klings 2. AM escape, but it's like a good trade, Sand King for 4 heroes. For my talents, anyone is curious about talents, I take attack speed at level 10, and then at level 15, it's kinda depending. If you are the single physical damage core on your hero, I would recommend taking the Jingu Mastery damage to have more damage output. But if you have another scaling hero for your mid lane, for example, you have like a TA or a Storm or something, a hero that can also dish out a lot of damage, then you can go for the tree dense cast range to chase better and like be more mobile around the map. And at level 20, I always go the Boundless Strike crit because of my build. Obviously, I go very physical damage build. And I'm not really playing around my Tree Dance Primal Spring usage. I mean, it's a lot of damage. It's 770 actually. No. It's 670. My bad, my bad. Math is hard. But yeah, I'm not really playing around that much. I'm using my stun more to farm. It's just my playstyle. Also, you like here, you just kill the wave instantly with a stun, and you don't have to channel your Primal Spring. There's no fight here right now, so I can just use it freely. And right now, I want to get the tower here and then work towards my Abyssal Blade because those are items you really need to make work with your ult. You want to have items like Echo Saber for the slow, and if you play against very mobile heroes like AM here, for example. You want to get an Abyssal Blade to really lock them down in your ult and do a lot of damage to them. So as my last item this game, I bought a Satanic. And basically why I bought Satanic is to stay alive. Like the lifesteal is actually insane when you use Satanic and then Boundless Strike. Also the passive lifesteal really helps you to stay alive and get the Jingu stacks without like dropping too low in HP. And basically now the game is pretty straightforward, like I'm super farmed. I have my 25 talent, I can just put it down, take objectives, and like that's one usage of your talent that's like very effective, that you can, if you push high ground, like a tower or something, and you know they don't have glyph, you can just preemptively ult and kill their buildings. So they have two options. Either they jump you and have to fight in your Wukong's command, which is like the dream for you, or they don't jump you, ignore your wait out the duration, which is 13 seconds. And in those 13 seconds, they can already use lose their barracks or their tower or something, and you can just disengage, wait for your cooldown. It's not the longest cooldown, 90 seconds, and then just come back and do the same thing again. Another very useful thing that when you have a battlefield is that you can farm ancients like triple stack, quad stack, or I don't know, five stack, without having any trouble, even though without lifesteal. Because due to your high range, you can like kite them in and out, like I do here. I pull them out, they run to me, I stun them when they run back, and I just hit the creep that is like running away from me. So I can kill the ancient stack from my cleave basically and lose no HP. Like this cost me zero resource. I kill it very fast and you can get very, very farmed if you have a lot of stacks for this. So to finish the video, here's like a different build for this game here. I went a pretty early nullifier because they had so much like force stuff and glimmer cape, and Pugna had decrap obviously and he bought an Aeon disc. So I really wanted to get my nullifier just to kill people. Like in some games you need to adjust your item builds, like I could have gotten a satanic here or something to fight against Meepo better, for example, or like get a bash. But here like the decrap would like screw me up so much, and that's why I really needed the nullifier. So yeah, like I said, some games you need to adjust your item build. Also queued up a rapier this game, funny enough, because like it was very hard, like we almost lost and barely came back. We won in the end, but yeah, it was a very tough game. So that's it then for this video. Oh, actually no, that's not it for the video. One more thing, like for like counters for Monkey King. For carry counters, they're not really that much heroes. I would consider that counter you a lot. Probably the worst case scenario is draw, and I mean Venge and draw, because obviously like you can get on top of draw, which is like a bonus point for you. Like not every hero has the ability to get on top of some hero, but Venge can swap her out, and if she gets a distance again and you have no way to close the gap, you just basically get shredded by Drowinger. So this is a very tough matchup to play, and you really need to, like here in this game, you really, really need the level 25, the big ring. If you don't have the big ring, like this is almost impossible to play, and that's why we were also losing that much. But when I got 25, the game basically turned around. Like that's why this talent is such a game changer. So yeah, that's it now for this video. I hope you guys enjoy and could see some variety in Monkey King. There are a lot of items you can buy, a lot of different builds you can go. You basically start with the same two big items every game when you play him as a carry, obviously. There are different builds for mid lane, but since I'm playing basically only in the safe lane, I always go these items. If you think the video was useful, you can leave a like, leave a comment, subscribe to the channel. And as always, whenever you watch it, have a good day, have a good night, and I hope I see you guys in the next video too. Goodbye, goodbye.